Timers are often used in video games to give players a sense of urgency or display the current time on a special ability. In this session, we'll walk through how you can create a Unity timer for your own game that has a single-click option to count up or count down. We'll also walk through how to add a flash effect to the timer once the time is up. And before you leave, hit those like and subscribe buttons. I've started a new project, made a canvas, and made my timer. If you need any help creating the UI in this step, there's a video that I have on creating a UI in Unity that you should check out. I've decided to do a digital timer, so I have these background assets here that will always display. They're not linked to any of the code or anything. They just sit there in the background. I also separated my minutes and seconds into separate meshes. You don't have to do this, but to get everything to line up on my digital display here, I decided to make everything a separate object. Everything lines up and everything is right justified. Most of the work here is going to be done through a custom script that we'll write. So I'm going to navigate to my scripts folder, right click in an open area, go to create, and then select C# script. I'll name this script timer. Then I'll double click to open this in Visual Studio. Now that the script is open, I'm going to do some really quick editing to get the formatting the way that I like it. We won't be using system collections or system collections generic, so I'm going to delete both of those. Because I've decided to use TextMesh Pro for my text in Unity, I'll need to add TMP Pro. Now let's declare our variables. I'm going to start with a private float, which will be our timer duration. I'm going to set this equal to 3 minutes, but because everything is in seconds, we will multiply this by 60. I'm also going to add a private float for our timer. Then I will also need our text components. So text mesh pro UGUI first minute. So this is the first slot for the minutes. I'm going to need 5 of these. Just going to copy this really quick. Second minute. And then our separator. Our first second, and our second second. We could get these all at runtime. What makes sense to do in this case is to serialize all of these fields so they show up in the editor. So we'll put serialize field above each of our text variables. I like to add things to functions for as much clarity as possible. So I'm going to declare a private void reset timer that we can use anytime we want our timer to start. We're going to also make an update timer display that will take in our time. We'll also create a function for our flash. We'll start with our countdown timer to make things a little bit more simple, and then at the end, we'll add in functionality so that we can count up. If we take a step back for a second and look at what we need to do for our countdown timer, the first thing is we need to set our current time to the time duration. Then we need to subtract the time that has elapsed from our timer. And lastly, we need to send that data to our text to be displayed on screen. So where I'd like to start is the reset timer. In my reset timer function, I want to set my timer equal to my time duration. Then I'll add this function on start. Within my update loop, I'll do a timer minus equals time.deltatime. This means that every frame or update, I will subtract the amount of time that has elapsed between those frames from my timer. But we only want to do this if our timer is above 0. So we'll add an if statement here. if timer is greater than 0. If it's not, that's when we want to perform our flash function. So we'll write an else flash. After we subtracted the elapsed time from our timer, we want to update our display. So we'll use the update timer display function and take in the variable timer. Here we'll create two local variables for minutes and seconds. We'll perform a math function for our minutes, the floor to int. And here we'll do a time divided by 60 because there are 60 seconds in a minute. It's useful to use floor to int to round our value down so that when we get to 0, we're actually at 0. Because floats can have lots of decimal places and something can look like 0 when it actually isn't. For seconds, we'll do math floor to int time. And we're going to use a percentage sign here. This basically is getting what's left over after you divide it by 60, which is great in this particular scenario because it's what's left over after we've gotten rid of all of minutes. Then we'll create a local string for the current time. We'll use a string.format function to declare our formatting. This will take in our minutes and our seconds. In the description, I'll provide a link to the Microsoft documents which detail this function. Lastly, I need to set my text to the characters in this string. So I'll start with my first minute variable, do a dot text, and we're going to set this equal to current time, and then in the array 0, the first part of that array. And because this is a character, we need to convert it to a string. As an example, if our current time was 3254, our current time at index 0 would be 3, our current time at index 1 would be 2, our current time at index 2 would be 5, and our current time at index 3 would be 4. I'll go through and do this for the other three parts of our timer as well. With this, the basic functionality of our timer should be ready to go. Back in Unity, I'm going to select my canvas in the hierarchy and drag my timer on to my canvas game object. Now I just need to assign my text to its corresponding variables. When I click play, you'll see that our timer starts at 3 minutes and is now counting down. However, if I go back into my script and change my time duration to just 3 seconds, you'll notice that our timer display breaks once we get below 0. We'll build a fix for that in our flash function. Within our flash function, we'll do a check for whether our timer is not equal to 0. Within our update, we only call the flash function if the timer is equal to or less than 0. Because of line 26, it's possible and even likely that our timer will drop below 0. Within our condition here, we can set our timer equal to 0 just in case it's negative. Then we can update our timer display with our timer again. Now you'll notice when I hit play in the editor, our value doesn't go below 0. Now let's build out our flash function. For this, we'll want two new float variables, private float flash timer and private float flash duration, which we'll set to 1. For our flash, we're going to break up the duration into two parts. So for half the duration, our text will be on, and the other half, our text will be off. We'll create a new function here called setTextDisplay, and it'll have a parameter that will be a bool that will control whether or not the text is enabled or not. This will be really simple. Just for all of our text, we're going to set the enabled status equal to our local enabled. We just need to do this 5 times because we also want to do our separator. For our if statement, we'll do our flash timer is less than or equal to 0. We will reset our timer to the flash duration. I'll create an else if here, if our flash timer is greater than or equal to our flash duration divided by 2, so half of our duration, then we want to increment our timer by the amount of time that has elapsed between frames, our delta time, and set the text display to false. For the other half of the flash duration, we still want to reduce our timer by the amount of time that has elapsed between frames, but instead of our text being set to false, we'll set our text to true. Now, when I hit preview in the editor, when we get to zero, you'll see that our text now flashes. Now, let's also configure the timer so that it can count up. In my script, I'm going to make a new private bool countdown variable. By default, I'll set this to true. Because I want the ability to set this in the editor, I'm going to serialize this field. Now we need to go through and make sure everything in our script is set up correctly to handle both of those conditions. In update, the timer being greater than equal should only be used if we're counting down. If we're not counting down, in other words, if we're counting up, we'll check if our timer is less than our timer duration. If it is, instead of subtracting from our timer, we'll add to it. In our flash function, our timer being not equal to zero will only apply if we are counting down. If we're not counting down or we're counting up, we'll need to instead check if our timer is not equal to the time duration. Instead of timer equaling zero here, we'll want it to equal the time duration. In our reset timer function, we'll need to set our timer depending on whether we're counting down or up. So if we are not counting down, we'll set our timer equal to zero. As a bit of a failsafe here too, I'll also set my text equal to true. In Unity, you can see in the timer, I now have a checkbox for countdown. If I uncheck countdown and hit play, we start at zero and count up to 3. Hopefully this video helped. If it did, please don't forget to like and leave a comment down below. If you'd like to see more game development and Unity tutorials just like this, hit subscribe, and I'll see you in the next one.